tonight on Montage. Model of a scam.
Then he like came over to me like to kiss me, and I said, I'm not into this.
I'm Jane Wells. This is legitimate modeling, but is the casting couch alive and well in South Florida? We'll find out.
South Florida's safest city. We'll take you to a place where the fish jump, the people are friendly, and there is virtually no crime. Plus...
All right, I think you drank too much.
We'll update our story about Maria, a 14-year-old who's now a mommy. And...
Montage, where the people really talk.
12 Questions with Richard Simmons. And Michael Putney will be around with his weekly column. All this and more on tonight's Montage.
Welcome to Montage. Hello, I'm Ed O'Dell. Coming up, a trip to South Florida's safest city and Michael Putney's column. But first, baby, Big Ed is going to make you a star. That is no doubt one of the oldest come-on lines in the entertainment world, but it still works. In fact, Jane Wells was just telling me that the old casting couch technique has been extremely successful here in South Florida.
You better believe it, Ed. Movies, commercials, television shows, it's all being done here in South Florida. And plenty of young, aspiring models and actors want to be a part of it. But nobody these days is supposed to fall for the old bit about you do something for me and I'll do something for you, right? Wrong. Meet some young people who fell for a model of a scam.
Chin down. That's it. Head down. That's good. Deep breath, too, now. Real deep breath. Good.
In Miami, the business is unbelievable because everyone's a model. You know, you walk down the street, oh, I model.
They all want to be stars. In this case, the young model has come to a respected photographer. She didn't find him through the classifieds, but that's where many people make mistakes. It's often here that naive souls filled with visions of Hollywood look for that big break and end up with empty dreams and a lesson about the casting couch. Take Universal Casting, for example. This is a Hollywood police report. In it, a young woman says she went to Universal Casting where a man named Chuck asked her into his office. According to this report, he said he wanted to do a layout for Penthouse magazine in which she'd take her clothes off. Quote, he wanted to put his finger on my vagina, and I said, that's enough. And I put my clothes on, and he had his zipper down, and he played with himself. That man, Chuck Gorson, was never charged with a crime. No one seems to know where he is. Universal Casting is no longer operating. But perhaps the most extreme example of how crazy this business gets is the case of the Fashionelle Modeling Agency. Meet three women who went there. They all paid hundreds of dollars to a man named Ronaldo. They wanted pictures and jobs. This is what they got.
Well, I just called because it said, let's see, $500 a day. A new cosmetic line needs models immediately.
The first time he didn't ask for any money. He was very nice, very friendly, and he said, you know, you have a profitable look, one that we can sell.
And the third visit, he started talking about different things that he expects from his models.
He says, I might touch you, I might position you or something like that, and is that going to upset you? And I said, well, you know, what do you mean? What do you mean by this?
And I really wasn't understanding until, you know, he started like going for me, and he goes, here, just relax and everything, and I said, whoa, this isn't for me.
He said he wanted to touch me and for me to lay down and everything, but I just said, I think I can create the look myself, you know.
And then he like came over to me like to kiss me, and I said, I'm not into this. And he said, well, then I can't work with you.
He made it very clear that there are a lot of girls available, and he says, there's a lot of pretty girls, Michelle. And he says, I can pick any one that I want, and basically, I'll pick the ones that make me feel good.
This is the man they're talking about, Ronaldo. His real name is Ron Nichols, but his story has taken a bizarre twist. Here's how police tell it.
One night last March, two women, Mindy Whitcraft and Liz Rutherford, came here to Fashionelle to talk with Ron Nichols. Mindy brought her brother, Roy. The two women were being asked by Ron to go to a modeling trip in Los Angeles. They said no, there was an argument, and the three left. Later, police say Roy Whitcraft came back here to confront Ron Nichols.
6 days later, Ron Nichols' badly beaten corpse was found in the trunk of a car at the Miami airport. Roy Whitcraft is charged with the crime. His sister Mindy didn't want her face shown. She also didn't want to talk about the crime. What she did say was that she had worked for Ron Nichols. She says Ron often used his models as part of an escort service and that his promising ads were all lies.
This $500 a day
cost was a scheme that he had made up to have people come in. In fact, he would sit there and ask everybody in the agency to try to think of a good ad to get the people to come in for.
Are you surprised by what happened to Ron Nichols?
No.
Ron Nichols is gone now, but professional photographers like Chuck St. John say there's still plenty of shady businessmen out there.
Every time you turn around, it seems like the state is closing one down and then another one opens up, so it's kind of hard to pinpoint how many there are, but I'd say there's at least, you know, 10 or 12 in this area.
He says don't believe everything you read in the classifieds. These aspiring models have learned that.
If you go to an agency and they promise you work, they say, oh, we can get you work, that's baloney. Don't believe them and just, you know, say, well, thank you very much and leave, because they can't do that. They can't promise you work.
And what about the casting couch?
You know, I would think that there are girls that would say, hey, that's all right with me. If he's going to shoot my pictures for this amount of money and he's a good photographer and he expects this, I'm willing to give it. Personally, I'm not.
Whoa. Jane, how do you avoid getting into a situation like this?
Find a respectable agent, usually through word of mouth, or call the Screen Actors Guild. They can tell you who to go to.
Now, what about that Ron Nichols murder? What's next there?
The defendant, Roy Whitcraft, goes to trial June 16th. He has pleaded not guilty to that murder.
Thanks, Jane. Don't go away. Montage is right back at you.
Still ahead.
Who's the unhealthiest person in the world?
12 questions with Richard Simmons. And coming up next, the safest city in South Florida. Could this be your neighborhood?
You hear so much about drugs, shootouts, and murder in South Florida, the things that make our area a major crime center in the nation. But what about the other side, the good things about our communities? There are some very safe neighborhoods on the Gold Coast. Ileana Bravo located one of these safe havens where people are friendly and the living is easy. In fact, Ileana calls one such area South Florida's safest city.
No one gets into South Florida's safest city unless these guys say so. It's no wonder the tiny and very exclusive island of Indian Creek Village in North Miami Beach had only one reported crime last year, a minor theft. A police force of 12 patrols 24 hours a day on land and sea. The residents pay through the nose for this type of protection, but they've got big bucks here.
We do take care of the people who live here and make sure that they're well protected.
All very special residents, I take it.
Not necessarily special, but they are, have been well known, most of them in the past, and some of them still are, like Julio.
Julio, as in Julio Iglesias, the Spanish singing star. He lives in a humble abode in this serene and super rich city by the sea, where even the golf carts are Rolls Royces.
So now you've seen it, Dade County's safest city. Kind of like a look at lifestyles of the rich and famous, huh? Believe me, people here are real proud of their non-existent crime rate, but they're not exactly willing to talk about it. You see, they're very private here. They're not going to invite you in for tea to chat about the latest crime statistics. For that kind of hospitality, we have to take you to another county.
Let's go north to Broward County, to South Florida's second safest city, where the folks are friendlier. It's a little town sandwiched between the Intracoastal and A1A. This mile and a half wide community, lying on the Fort Lauderdale coast, south of Pompano, is considered a safe haven in the middle of an urban jungle.
How you been?
How's everything going?
Well, good. You got a real good tan there, buddy.
Good day yesterday at the beach.
Yeah?
I'll catch you later on.
All right, take it easy.
The southern hospitality is courtesy of Sea Ranch Lakes, population 675. And according to Florida law enforcement records, it's Broward's safest city, with only 13 crimes reported last year. Actually, they all occurred outside the residential area in the community shopping mall. A state-certified police force here uses down-home methods to tackle big city problems.
That's Mrs. Matthews now. She wanted to show you her house the other day, but you didn't have time.
Meet Police Chief Tony Mazza. He knows all the residents here, and they know him. He says the cops depend on the residents to pitch in the fight against crime.
But I say 90% of the residents call us when they see something suspicious, and that really helps. And the biggest thing that helps us also here is that most homes in the village are hooked up to an alarm system right in the police department.
But you don't hear a lot of alarms or sirens in Sea Ranch Lakes, just the peaceful sounds of chirping birds and fish jumping in the lake. So what do the police do in this incessantly quiet place? What's their biggest crime challenge?
Keeping the unauthorized people out of the village and patrolling the walls and the fence that surround this village.
I'll bet a lot of police departments wish those were their worst problems. Makes you wonder if all this peace and quiet seems a little like semi-retirement to a former New York City Fire Department veteran.
Anytime you put a weapon on and you stop a car, which we do, and we give out tickets, you have a very, very, very great chance of getting your brains blown out. So you never can become complacent. When you strap on a weapon, you strap on a badge, you become a target.
On this day, Officer Jerry Wilson responds to a resident's call.
Oh, they're in here now, okay. Great. Thank you much.
Finally, he finds the culprits the neighbor complained about. The intruders are a litter of stray kittens.
Hello, kitties. Come on, come on, come on.
There we go, as we load these vicious criminal cats in here.
And how does a former Michigan cop justify this kind of nonsense call?
Serve and protect.
You've done all the challenging police work up north.
I've done the protecting. I'm trying to serve now.
Debbie Casey, who grew up in this neighborhood, appreciates the little things the officers do for them.
If you have an emergency, they're right there. And just even little things that, if you were in any other community, you couldn't call upon a policeman to help you. I think it's like it probably was 50 years ago.
Marilyn Seck says the huge family dog has been more pussycat than watchdog since they moved down here from Rhode Island 5 years ago.
You read the papers and I don't see the crime, but obviously it's present. But you're right, we seem to be untouched here.
But does untouched by crime also mean insulated from the real world? Both the residential village and the beach club across the street are private. Only an established middle-upper class can afford to buy their privacy here. Homes start at $300,000. What it means is that money buys safety. That's merely a sign of the times. But somehow these modern-day folks have also managed to preserve some of the ways of yesteryear.
There is a family spirit here. We still have this small-town way of life. It's like living in the country. And I grew up on a farm, so I love it. I wouldn't have it any other way.
Old-fashioned pride in their community, a lesson other South Floridians might learn. Police in this safe city are glad law enforcement is a two-way street.
Ileana, I know all of us want to know, why can't there be other communities like that in South Florida? What can other communities do to be like that neighborhood?
Well, what they should do is pitch in and learn to have that sort of community spirit that we've learned that the people at Sea Ranch Lakes have. But, of course, we should point out that they have the money to pay for their seclusion as well.
But we still need more like them. Thank you, Ileana. Montage will return.
Next on Montage.
I swear to God I didn't do it. I swear I was not in my hotel room. The dead body, I don't know where the knife came from, okay? I just came down here for vacation.
12 questions only Montage would ask Richard Simmons.
In journalism, we sometimes have what we call a real slow week. We're all affected by it, even that news magnate Michael Putney. But somehow, by week's end, someone will put their foot in his or her mouth, and a smiling Michael Putney will say, go ahead, make my column.
Ed, it was a slow news week until Robert Chevin showed up at Miami's Tiger Bay Club and reamed us butt good at Channel 4.
But the worst, in my view, character assassins of all in the past 4 months in this community have done their deeds on South Miami Avenue at Channel 4.
Wow. Mr. Chevin is PO'd because he thinks he'd be the Democratic nominee for governor right now if we just hadn't said anything about this letter he wrote for Alberto San Pedro. You know, the one in which he says, over the past 2 years, I've had the opportunity to become well acquainted with Al San Pedro on a personal basis. Throughout this period, I have found his integrity, character, and personal conduct to be irreproachable.
What's newsworthy about a 7-year-old letter? Nothing.
And later he told me there's nothing newsworthy about judges partying with San Pedro.
Do you not think that perhaps the fact that a number of judges in Dade County simply have eaten his food, accepted liquor, have gone to his party, do you think that that is not newsworthy?
No, I really don't. Particularly if they didn't know anything about his background at the time.
Mm-hmm. But he wouldn't have said that when he was the Attorney General. Well, as it happens, Bob Chevin isn't the only guy who was put out with us in the news media. Miami Police Colonels Gil Zamora and Walter Martinez also did a number on us this week, but they only wanted to do it in Spanish.
And the reason it was intended to be for the Hispanic media is that it seems to me like they usually get cut short and don't get enough information about things that have happened.
Now, what he is really saying is, we English language reporters are doing a number on Cuban police officers, to which I say, coño. All right, let's see. Anybody else out there who is mad as hell and isn't going to take it anymore? Yep. There's Adolfo Calero, the head of the Nicaraguan Democratic Front. Here's what Calero said this week about the people who filed a federal lawsuit accusing him and other country leaders of smuggling cocaine to finance their movement. Listen carefully.
Well, they better think of life insurance.
Better get life insurance. Ominous, and only in Miami. Ed?
Thanks, Mike. Back in March, we brought you the story of a 14-year-old girl having a baby. Since then, a lot has happened. Here's Amy Huggins with an update on Maria's baby.
Ed, we had wanted to do the definitive story on the epidemic of teen pregnancies by focusing on just one girl. We chose Maria Wright because she's typical of the 1 million teens who get pregnant in the U.S. each year. She's poor, she knew about contraception but didn't use any, and she chose not to have an abortion. Here's more on Maria's baby.
Okay, now Vietnam is where America was involved in the war.
Maria Wright's back in seventh grade after an extended absence. She wasn't sick, she had a baby.
How are you doing, Maria?
You guys ready?
You feel good? What do you think of your baby?
I think it's so cute.
Oh, she's precious. She's adorable.
Oh, goodness.
How hard was it for you?
Easy.
Here's 8-pound Amy. No, she wasn't named after me. She was born in the back seat of a car after her mother was in labor for just 3 hours. Maria's mom, 30-year-old Bert Miller, was happy that a trying pregnancy was over.
She's been a total pain. But she's been working it out.
She is trying. After Amy was born, Maria moved back in with her 18-year-old husband, Freddie. She had left him shortly after they were married because Maria says he hit her.
You're dead to the world.
2 weeks after giving birth, Maria was still getting the hang of waking Amy up and changing her diapers.
Tired.
You're tired?
Yeah.
Why? What's so tiring about being a mother?
Well, she keeps you up all night long. Don't let you get any sleep at all, but that's okay.
I'm praying to God that she will see the light and not do this again. This will keep her busy.
Maria returned to school 3 weeks ago, older and much wiser, but still with a whole lot more to learn.
Okay, when we look at the map, what country is this?
Amy is going to keep tabs on what happens to Maria and her baby and have more stories for you. Now, if cellulite has taken over the spot where your thighs used to be, you might want to hang around for this segment. Montage asks the high priest of sweat, Richard Simmons, 12 very important and unusual questions.
How healthy is South Florida?
Not very healthy at all. I mean, they eat terrible here. I mean, the beaches have sour cream on them. It's not healthy.
What vegetable best describes your personality?
A laughing jicama.
Who's the unhealthiest person in the world?
Oh, I don't think Nancy Reagan eats. I think she just smells food. I think the woman is actually have to eat and chew. You know, I don't think she's very healthy.
If you had to come back as an insect, which would you be?
A butterfly.
Complete this sentence. In high school gym class, I was famous for...
stealing food out of other people's lunch bags. Because I had asthma, hay fever, sinus, peptic ulcer, and flat feet, so I didn't have to take pee, so it was just like a two-hour cafeteria for me.
You seem so flexible. What position can you not get into?
Begging.
What is the greatest misconception about you?
That I'm always funny, and I'm really always very serious. I think if you want to motivate people, you have to do it with humor. That's the only time they'll listen.
Is your belly button an innie or an outie?
Mine was removed. It was an auto accident. It was a rainy night. It was in France. It was smoky. I was alone. The car, it skid off, and they had to remove it. I have an innie. That way you can put hollandaise sauce in it, and you can just, you know, dip French fries.
What exercise do you hate the most?
Sit-ups! I hate them! I hate them! I hate them!
What's your motto?
My motto is never, ever give up.
How important is head cheese to your diet?
I don't eat animals. I don't eat them at all. I think it's a sin.
What's your greatest fear?
Dying. Because I can't imagine this world living without me. Who's going to take care of all these people?
We are just about out of time, but before I let you go, we have one correction to be made in a story we aired last week, Miami Beach Dead or Alive. We said that the Comedy Room, a club on the beach, was relocating because of financial problems. Well, that just isn't the case, even though the owners of the club and officials at the Barcelona Hotel admit that during the week, it's pretty slow there. They say they're making ends meet, and they're going to hang in there. Now, before we go, let me give you one more reminder. Write us with your questions and comments in care of Montage, 316 North Miami Avenue, Miami 33128. It's so good to hear from you. For Mike, Ileana, Jane, and Amy, I'm Ed O'Dell saying, be with us again next time. Have a great week. Good night.
There's a certain look that he wanted to get from me, kind of a sexual look.
He said, you know, you have a profitable look, one that we can sell.
He started talking about different things that he expects from his model.
Every man is the same, come on. I'll make you a star. I'll take you a million miles from all this. But you want a better star. Come on.
Next week on Montage, right before 60 Minutes.
There was nobody standing next to me pulling the trigger. That was me.
A murderer jailed for almost 40 years. Has he paid enough?